Hello, I'm Harley Schlanger from the Schiller Institute. Welcome to our weekly dialogue with Helga Zepp LaRouche, the founder and chairman of the Schiller Institute. It's December 30th, 2020, and as we're heading to the new year, there is still so much uncertainty and tension in the world. And Helga, there are things that President Trump can do between now and January 6th and the 21st that would make a big difference. What would you suggest that he take on?
Well, again, you know, if you believe the mainstream media, it's all a done deal. You know, Trump is just not able to lose and not concede. The reality is, you know, we still are dealing with the biggest election fraud in the history of the United States. And if this is not fraud, and the United States is turned into a banana republic, which is what the mainstream media, the social media, are all trying to demonstrate, that it doesn't matter what the voters vote, because it is the establishment which decides who is the government. If that cannot be changed, then, you know, I think this forebodes extremely bad for the so-called Western values, not only in the United States, but throughout the world. Therefore, if Trump, you know, he's clearly mobilizing, he's preparing for January 6th, the big date, rallies in Georgia on the 4th, in Washington on the 6th. But, you know, I think it would be much better to turn the table, because if you are playing in a rigged game, it is no point in, you know, playing the game which has been imposed on you. So I think the best thing Trump could do, you know, and I don't know if he's going to do it, but what he should do, he should counter this present anti-Russia, anti-China, absolute hysterical campaign, which is escalating in the United States and also in Europe to a certain extent. But he should immediately respond to Putin's offer to conduct a P5 summit, a summit of the permanent five members of the UN Security Council, in order to discuss the emergencies which are confronting humanity. That is the pandemic, to coordinate international efforts to fight the COVID pandemic, to fight the famine, a famine which threatens 270 million people in the coming year, according to the World Food Program, to straighten out the danger of an escalation militarily, which could lead to a military incident and by accident or intent trigger World War III, to change this whole dynamic, to address the pending financial blowout of the system. So if Trump really wanted to change the dynamic, he should respond to Putin's offer. You know, Macron has said earlier he would immediately agree to such a summit. The Chinese have, and I think even Boris Johnson has signaled that he would participate. So I think to have a forum to discuss these big challenges, in my view, is the most important question. Then naturally, Trump should use the flank of pardoning Snowden and Assange, because they could spill the beans on what's behind Russiagate. I think this would be one of the most effective new elements in the situation. Naturally, the exoneration of my late husband, Lyndon LaRouche, must be part of the package, because only if you address the entirety of what people call the deep state, which is the same apparatus behind Russiagate and the prosecution of my husband, you really want to go at the roots of that, that is what should be done. He can order the declassification of all the documents pertaining to the coup attempt, to the Russiagate, unredacted, and make it known to the public so that everybody can see who are the culprits. He has already talked about the appointment of a special counsel who should investigate all of that. That should be done as part of the package. And, you know, naturally, then the mobilization of the population for January 6th and beyond. You know, the fraud which occurred in the United States election is not done, even if, you know, it cannot be remedied on January 6th. It will be an issue because this incoming Biden administration will have the absolute shadow of legitimacy, or lack of that actually, over it hanging. So I think all of these things must be continued, because you cannot go in the direction of what these people are planning without that it has the gravest strategic and domestic consequences. So that would be my advice to President Trump.
One example of the kind of statecraft that could be done was the Schiller Institute participation at the Alexandrov Memorial the other day. That was quite a moving event, wasn't it?
Yes, this is something we have done now for the fourth time. You know, this was a memorial for the plane crash, which took place over Sochi on the 25th of December 2016, where 92 people got killed, including 64 members of the Alexandrov Ensemble. And we have, together with the fire department in Bayonne and other authorities from New York, had this memorial with the Russian mission now for the first time. And this time it was addressed by the Deputy Ambassador Shumakov from the Russian mission in New York. And he made a very important speech, which I just want to give you a quote. He said, I would like to express our deep appreciation to the Schiller Institute and the Fire Department of Bayonne. Annual meetings like this one have become our good tradition, which makes them all the more significant. We commend the efforts of the American community to preserve the memory of those outstanding Russian musicians and luminaries in the United States. This year, even the coronavirus pandemic could not stop us from gathering here. Solidarity and mutual help are especially needed today, when humanity has faced an unprecedented threat, COVID-19 pandemic. For the sake of our common future, people and states of the world need to erase all dividing lines and channel their creative forces to articulating a joint response to this global challenge. Russia and the United States, as two permanent members of the Security Council, bear special responsibility for sustaining global peace and security, and so forth and so on. So I think this is very, very important, because, you know, it is the need to go back to dialogue, which is expressed here. So that is what I wanted to mention.
Well, and that is the kind of statecraft you've been discussing. Now, in contrast to that, we see provocations from NATO against Russia and Russian comments on that, and also this intense anti-China rhetoric continuing from people like Grinnell, Pillsbury, and now that Biden joined in a press conference. Where is this going?
Well, as I said many times before, you know, when you demonize nuclear powers like Russia and China and accuse them of things which they are clearly not doing, then it only has one purpose: to create an enemy for a future war. And when Biden basically says that he will hold China accountable for all kinds of things, we have to expect that with the Biden administration, you will see an escalation from the already extremely bad relation between the United States and these two countries. And examples of this hysteria were given by two people talking to Fox News: Grinnell, the former U.S. ambassador to Berlin, and Pillsbury, a notorious China hater. And they all, you know, were just saying China is about to take over the world. This is not true. China is not trying to do that at all. It's all part of the strategy of the neocons to decouple the economies of the U.S. and China, which will only hurt the United States. It will hurt the U.S. population and U.S. firms, because, as we can discuss a little later, China is actually doing quite well, contrary to the Western countries. But this is very, very dangerous, and it is really something people should counter, because, You can drive a population into a hysteria, a warmongering, which then in the consequence leads to war. And who would benefit from that? Nobody.
Well, and in this same context, you have the line going out in the United States that Biden is an agent of China and that Biden is a socialist or a communist. In reality, he's pushing corporate fascist measures.
Yeah, this is really absurd. You know, I mean, you know, but once you have a McCarthy witch hunt, you know, people become stupid. A good example is Nikki Haley, who is obviously pushing her presidential campaign for 2024. She says this is socialism. Socialism has become mainstream with the Democratic Party. I mean, if the Democratic Party is socialist, you know, then, you know, the sky consists out of green cheese, you know. I mean, it's so absurd. I mean, these epithets like socialism, communism, Marxism, I mean, these are not Marxists. These are not communists. These are people who are leaning, as you say, into corporatism, into a form of, you know, green dictatorship, which, you know, in the consequences is much worse than fascism. So people should be clear on what they say. And I can only refer to Confucius, who said that, you know, if you want to straighten out a problem, you have to first get your notions straight. Because if your notions don't fit reality, then out of that follow wrong deeds, out of that follows tension, out of that follows war. And I think that we are in a situation where these wise words of Confucius should be applied.
I think in that sense, it's worth taking a look at what the Great Reset is, which you've been out front exposing. This is not a socialist program. It's a program to consolidate power in the hands of the central banks for the purpose of the Green New Deal. And this seems to be the direction that the Biden administration is going.
Yes, you know, the financial system is hopelessly bankrupt. We are actually seeing a major economic collapse. The housing bubble in the United States is 25% larger than it was in 2008. There will, unless some major legislation is done in the last minute, there will be lots of evictions. You know, you will have a collapse of the housing situation, a lot of social tension. You have other signs of economic collapse in Europe. So when they try now to go for a new bubble with the carbon-free economy, and that has actually been for the first time in the budget bill, which just was passed by the Congress, that the United States also is supposed to go into the direction of a zero carbon emission economy, which is what the EU already is doing. And that means, you know, a complete assault on the United States and Europe as industrial powers. Because if you, you know, you don't push nuclear, you go out of carbon, out of gas, out of fossil fuels in general, then you end up in very low energy flux densities, and that means you collapse the industry. So this is a path to disaster, but that is what Biden will go with, and also the Davos crowd. They will have a virtual conference between the 25th and 29th of January, where they will push the propaganda for that. But I want to reiterate, even if it seems to be now almost a consensus, this whole green agenda and reset is based on fraudulent science. There is climate change without any question, but it has almost nothing to do with what man's activity is on the planet. It has everything to do with the galactic position of the Earth. It has to do with galactic cycles. Weather changes or changes of weather patterns are taking place since millions of years, changing ice ages, warming periods, small ice ages. You know, we are in contact with hundreds, if not thousands, of scientists around the world who contest this. It's not true that there is a consensus among scientists. So we will discuss this more in the coming period, but people should really not be fooled by a scheme which has only one purpose, to bail out a completely bankrupt banking system. And the only remedy for that is what my late husband has designed as a program. You have to close down the casino economy of the City of London and Wall Street. You have to implement the four laws LaRouche has designed: Glass-Steagall, banking separation, go back to a Hamiltonian banking system, national banks, a new Bretton Woods system among these national banks, and then gear up credit for production and real investment in real production and not green, which is a destruction of industry. So I call on all people who have an interest to save the future that you should please join in with us to put these other questions on the agenda and not fall for this green reset.
Well, the great reset and the green agenda is actually much more feudalist or corporate fascist. And the confusion of that with socialism is just designed to mix up and divert people's attention from reality. Now, contrast that with the Xi-Putin discussion that just took place, where they put forward a joint perspective. This is something that, again, Americans don't know about.
Yes. These two leaders, Xi Jinping and Putin, just had a telephone conversation, and they reiterated their in-depth cooperation for joint economic investment, for scientific cooperation, for joint efforts to distribute vaccines all over the world. And they stressed the long, deep friendship between those two countries. Now, Brzezinski already many years ago had asserted that, you know, friendship between China and Russia is impossible, while he's completely proven wrong on that point as well as on many others. And, you know, I think that there is such a thing like friendship among countries, because if you act in the interest of the other and you have a joint mission, in this case, Russia and China having a commitment to, you know, overcome poverty also in the developing countries, then, you know, that joint mission gives you a depth for and a basis for friendship, which you don't have if you are if you are lacking such an agapic quality.
You mentioned before the housing crisis in the United States. One more economic note: there's a hospital crisis, a clinic crisis emerging in Germany, and in the midst of this, you have Altmaier combining green policy and privatization, which is causing the crisis. This is exactly the wrong way to go.
Yeah, especially because the coronavirus crisis is clearly out of control. I mean, they're talking now in terms of Germany about, these are just rumors, not officially, but it's circulating in articles and so forth, about a possible lockdown way into April. I mean, can you imagine what the economic damage of that is? They have not been able so far to get the infection rate under control, despite a relative severe lockdown, not total, but significant. And they want to close down, or, you know, there is the threatening insolvency of, you know, if things don't get better, 2/3 of German hospitals. Can you imagine that? A similar crisis exists in France, in Italy, and naturally in the United States, where the corona situation is totally out of control, in California, in Southern California, Central California, other places. So this is clearly, you know, something which is not the case in Asia. You know, you do have recurring cases in South Korea, in China, but, you know, there is a clear awareness that China and Asia in general, they did so much better. You know, this was even stated by by an Italian military magazine, that China is the winner out of this pandemic. But there is no reason to relax, because Dr. Tedros from the World Health Organization just made a very important speech, and people, before they go into hysteric reactions about this person, you know, who has clearly done well, and what he says people should take to heart. He said, it's completely ununderstandable how the Western countries are in a cycle between panic when a pandemic breaks out, then they throw cash at it, but then they go into, you know, neglect. They do not anything to remedy the reasons why the pandemic was possible in the first place. And he said this kind of cycle is devastating because there are clear indications that worse pandemics are going to come. And this is why I'm reiterating the program of the Schiller Institute and the LaRouche organization in general, that we have to have a world health system in every, we have to have a national modern health system in every single country. Because if you only think about the so-called your own country or the industrial countries, and you're leaving the developing countries, you know, unattended, the pandemic will come back and the virus will mutate, and all your vaccines may not function with a mutated virus or some new virus. So I think, you know, the idea that we absolutely need 1.5 billion productive jobs, that we need to really work together with all countries, including Russia, China, to build up modern health systems in Mexico, in Haiti, in Mali, in every single country on the planet, is really extremely important. So while it is good that the vaccination has begun, the United States has already vaccinated more than 2 million people, China 1 million people, Germany only 40,000, which is, you know, not up to speed. But the problem is that of all the produced vaccines, 85% so far have been allocated to the so-called Western countries. I am not sure I have all the figures for China and Russia in this respect. But, you know, unless you go for the kind of international solidarity and cooperation, this problem cannot be defeated. Dr. Elders, who is the former Surgeon General of the United States, issued a very important statement recently where she said that it is not enough to wait passively for vaccination, but you have to get the whole population mobilized, that they learn basic hygiene, basic anti-pandemic behavior, in this case, masks, social distancing, contact tracing, quarantine, and that has to be part of a national and international mobilization of the population. So I think, you know, we are not in a time where you can relax, but we definitely need to change a system which has bred that. And that means we have to overcome the poverty in the developing countries, or else we will not be able to defeat this.
Well, one of the solutions for hysteria and panic is beautiful culture. We just have a couple minutes left, Helga, but I'd like you to reiterate what you see as the importance of this Beethoven year being extended into the next year.
Well, I think everybody who is aware of the many crises the world finds itself in knows you need a source of strength, of beauty. Now, I do not know of any better way to access the most profound emotions and therefore a source to your own creativity than the music of Beethoven, because it uplifts you immediately. It carries you to the kind of planes where, you know, creative discovery takes place, and, you know, it purifies your emotions when you do it. The works of Beethoven is so unbelievably rich that if you, you know, immerse yourselves into long listening of different, you know, compositions, when you do that, you end up being a better person when you have finished it. And, you know, this question of classical culture is the way how people become better people. Schiller talked about that in the preface to his drama, The Bride of Messina, where he said that, you know, when people go into a theater to listen to a classical drama or a classical concert, a force is evoked in them, which makes them more powerful, more beautiful, and a better person. And that force does not go away when you leave the theater. And that's why I think we have to really do that a lot, because I'm convinced that with now the time is too short to discuss all the reasons, but I'm absolutely convinced that if we do not improve the moral character of the people who have tolerated a lot of what went wrong for too long, unless we have such a aesthetical improvement and a cultural renaissance of classical culture, I don't think humanity will get out of this crisis. This was also the view of Lyndon LaRouche, who always said that, you know, people have to learn to think in a classical way, because that goes together with agape. And without agape, whatever you are trying to do, I think you should listen to the 13th letter of the Corinthian. You know, you may have all of these things, but they are empty shells unless you have agape. And classical music is what causes you to be able to feel that. So that's why I'm for extending the Beethoven year because of the corona crisis until all the concerts which were not able to hold physically, until that can take place. And maybe we should never end the Beethoven year at all, because it's the state of mind people should be in general.
Well, Helga, thank you for joining us today. I wish you a happy new year, and to all of our viewers, not just a happy new year, but work to make it a better year in 2021.
Yes, I absolutely wish you a happy new year and a whole new year and a successful new year for mankind.
Okay, see you next week, Helga.
Till next week.